Hi, I'm Agent Ford. Do you think you can help me solve another true crime mystery? They were beaten, sexually assaulted, fed bleach, and suffocated before their bodies were found far apart. One in a trash can, the other with multiple gunshot wounds, having been set ablaze. You would think this wasn't human life. You would think this wasn't premeditated murder. The story of Channon Christian and Christopher Newsome has never ceased to shake the few who have heard of it, gracing their cheeks with tears as they ponder just how brutal, cold, and dark the heart of a man is. Channon Gale Christian was born on April 29, 1985, in Natchitoches, Texas. Her life was careless at this point. She was a senior at the University of Tennessee and had a boyfriend whom she was said to love so much, even though they had just started dating the previous year in November 2006. Her boyfriend, Christopher Gavin Newsome Jr., was born in 1983 and was 23 years old when the pair first met. Channon and Chris were deeply in love with each other, and the parents of both kids were aware of their relationship and approved of it. They had such a promising life as a couple, but this was to change. On Saturday, January 6, 2007, in Knoxville, Tennessee, where the pair lived, Channon was set to attend a birthday party with her friend and afterward head out on a date with Chris. She waited for Chris to come and pick her up. However, Channon and Chris would never arrive at the party. Their friends, upon fearing that something had come up, would head back to the apartment. There they would find Chris's car, but Channon's 4Runner was missing, as well as the couple. Earlier, while Channon waited, Chris arrived in his car. While the two were hugging each other closely, locked in an embrace, another car pulled up in the Washington Ridge apartment parking lot. Two black men got out of the car, walked towards Chris's car, and made the couple get into the Toyota 4Runner. Later identified as Boyd and Davidson, the two men rode the 4Runner while another black male, Cobbins, drove their own car behind them. After Channon and Chris had been forced into the car, the group drove back to Davidson's apartment on the Chipman Street. This was late at night at about 12 a.m. Cobbins parked and made it into the house first, where his girlfriend, Vanessa Coleman, and his friend, George Thomas, were waiting. Davidson would walk in with Channon, who was blindfolded and had both hands tied. Boyd then stepped in with Chris, who was also blindfolded and tied up. A Waste Connections worker named Jenkins Xavier lived close by and said that he had seen the four black males in the Toyota 4Runner at their apartment. He also said that he saw Chris being led out of the car blindfolded in the apartment. Chris was sodomized with an object while the group was masturbating as this assault was carried out. This would be confirmed by the seminal fluid found on Chris's body. When they were done with Chris, he was led to a rail track close to the house. He was forced to walk down wearing nothing but his shirt. They made sure he was barefoot and had him face the other direction. He was then shot multiple times. One of the rounds went into his head, destroying his brainstem, while the others went into his neck and back. Chris was reportedly still alive until that final round was launched into his skull. After he was confirmed dead, his head was wrapped in a sweater, his body laced with gasoline, and then set ablaze. His scarred remains were found on January 7th. The medical examiner predicted that he died on January 7th, 2007, at about 1:45 a.m. With Chris dead, the gang would head back to the apartment where they began their assault on Channon. She was beaten and then repeatedly sexually assaulted. Then bleach was forced down her throat and around vital body parts where she had been defiled in an attempt to destroy evidence of the act. Still alive, she was bound, covered with 5 garbage bags, and put into the trash can, where she would die of suffocation. Her eyes were said to have been wide open when she was found. Following a complicated series of investigations, the perpetrators would be found, one by one. Cobbins ran away with Vanessa, his girlfriend, to Kentucky. Very soon after, the search for the Toyota 4Runner started. Witnesses came forward. Soon after, the car was found in the Chipman Street apartment, Davidson's house. Chris's body was identified on the rail tracks, and Channon's corpse was found in the trash can. An arrest warrant was sent out for the boys. While Cobbins and Vanessa were in Kentucky, Eric and Davidson were looking desperately for a place to hide. They went to a friend who turned them in after he found out what they had done. They also went to a neighbor close by. She tried to turn them in, so they broke into another home. The owners were away, so they were able to stay there for some time, but eventually, Eric Boyd went back to his house to get something to eat. A McDonald's bag was found with him, along with some other items. Chris's brand new Nike shoes were found on Cobbins, and he also gave his girlfriend Vanessa some of Shannon's personal stuff. Vanessa's diary was found, and a comment she made was released to the internet. It expressed her joy about the adventure on the day of the murder. Vanessa said she was not aware of what was going on as she was in the back room, but later one of the guys confessed to being able to hear what had happened in the other room, as there were no doors present in the house. Cobbins would later testify that Davidson, his brother, had only told them they were going to see a female friend of his that was living in that apartment, and that Eric Boyd knew her pretty well because he dated her cousin. He would deny knowing that the car hijacked and kidnapped was premeditated. Meanwhile, Lamarisis Davidson and Eric Boyd had previously planned to hijack a car, and unfortunately, Channon and Chris were out at just that moment. Cobbins said they moved around the block a couple of times before parking. Police would trace Cobbins to the house they were hiding in. He was arrested along with Davidson. Before the crime, Eric Boyd and Davidson had both been in prison together. Eric Boyd was convicted of a felony and other petty crimes, while Davidson was convicted of minor crimes about carjacking, robberies, and dealing in illegal drugs. They met in prison and became friends. Eric Boyd was about 10 years older than Davidson, so some people say that it was Eric who influenced Davidson, but the younger criminal was arrested a lot earlier than Eric. 8 years later, George Thomas would agree to testify against Eric Boyd to get his sentence reduced. Witnesses testified that Eric Boyd was seen entering the apartment. Christopher Newsom's mom also remarked that she had a kind of mother's intuition that Boyd shot her son. Boyd bluntly denied having anything to do with Channon and Chris's kidnapping, sexual assault, and murder. The odds were stacked against him, though, as a Waste Connection worker testified seeing four black males ride the Toyota. The four black males were Lamarisis Davidson, Eric Boyd, George Thomas, and Latavius Cobbins. More so, Eric had previous charges of violent shootings and was said to have no regard for human life. He kept arguing that he only gave them the car borrowed from his cousin and had done nothing more than covering up and protecting Davidson. The prosecuting counsel had sworn to make sure Eric Boyd dies in prison. However, the latter refused to accept a guilty verdict, saying there was no forensic evidence against him. He also said that he would continue to appeal until he was absolved of all charges. 11 years later, on March 20th, 2018, Eric Boyd's last trial was held. The grand jury found him guilty on 36 counts, including premeditated murder, a first-degree felony, murder, aggravated kidnapping, robbery, and sexual assault. He was held in jail for about a month with a bail bond of $1 million. However, George Thomas agreed to testify against Eric Boyd in 2019 as a witness. The jury found him guilty on almost every charge, including the sexual assault of both Channon and Christopher. He was sentenced to life imprisonment. Meanwhile, Lamarisis Davidson was sentenced to 80 years in prison and eventually death. Latavius Cobbins was sentenced to life imprisonment without parole, and George Thomas was given life imprisonment with the possibility of parole after 51 years. Vanessa Coleman would be charged as an accessory to murder and sentenced to 53 years without parole, later reduced to 35 years. She was later denied parole and is still in prison today. While on trial, Channon's dad said to Vanessa, "For me personally, you took my baby. You took my opportunity to say yes to a young man one day. You took my wedding dance away. You took my chance to hold her child, my grandbaby." Cobbins later gave a really long testimony in court. He mentioned smoking a wet blunt that destabilized him and that he got scared after the kidnapping and wanted to go home. But Davidson brought out the gun. He said he talked to Channon and got her water, and while he was talking to her, she pleaded to him to talk to his brother into letting her go. She had offered to do anything. Cobbins said he made Channon give him oral sex, after which he left. Then Davidson convinced George Thomas to go in with him. Together, they spent some time in the room where Channon had been tied, coming out periodically. He said he was not aware of whatever was happening and that his only contact with Channon was previously stated. He also mentioned that Davidson made him, Vanessa, and George watch him strangle Channon to death. This statement was proved untrue as Channon was still alive as she was thrown into the trash can. She is believed to have died from suffocation. The murder brought out a lot of heat, with many television stations refusing to cover the case, hiding from spurring a multiplicity of socially injurious interpretations. People felt it was a race battle rather than seeing it as precisely what it was: two humans tortured, raped, and killed without remorse. Cobbin's testimony and the wrong media coverage would lead to the creation of the Channon and Christopher's Laws in 2014. These laws prevented victims from being antagonized as supposed misbehaviors were brought into the trial to dispute victims' reputations. One of the rules, the Christopher Newsom Act, allowed the jury's verdict to stand without the judge's signature, while the other, the Channon Christian Act, prevents the defense counsel and attorneys from painting victims in a bad light, especially by bringing up allegations on their character. Other activities like fundraisers, scholarships, and memorials have also been held. I genuinely hope Channon and Christian are at peace wherever they are. Let me know in the comments below what you guys think about this case. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to hit that like button and share it with your fellow investigators. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Hit that notification bell so you never miss a case. With that being said, stay safe, and I'll see you guys at the next crime scene.